Now, without reviewing everything, remember, we are looking at really three key points. The first is that recognition that God declares us righteous. He justifies us by faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ. It is not by anything that we have done, not by any religious ritual like circumcision or anything else, not by keeping any moral standards of commandments. No, what Jesus did on the cross when he died as a substitute for us, for our sins, rising from the dead, that is the basis for our forgiveness. That is the basis for now us having a righteous standing before God, period. Now, we might have sinned a lot, but all of our sins are under the blood of Jesus Christ. That's how much God loves us. That's God's grace, his free gift, because we certainly, as I said, did not earn this and didn't add to it in any way. Now, Paul had asked the question, well, shall we go ahead then and sin so that grace can abound, right? I mean, if God just shows his tremendous grace and love through our sins, let's just send up a storm. And he said, no, God forbid. And that really focused now on our second point, which is, what does it mean to believe in Jesus Christ? Not just the idea of heaven, okay, my sins are forgiven, I don't owe God anything for my sins, I will not face his wrath and judgment, I certainly won't be sent to hell, all of that future, but what does it mean for the now? We read from Galatians at the beginning of our service, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. That's the issue, isn't it? I am seen through faith in Jesus as being crucified with Christ. But I'm still living my life down here, the life I live in the flesh. So we are to live unto God. And this is what Paul's second key point was in Romans, was by saying by that connection to Christ, we need to make a calculation. I'm pointing to my head with the idea that this is an inward thing. I could be pointing to my heart. But the point is we reckon. We commute, we do this transaction that, as he said, I am dead to sin. Why? Because my old man is crucified with Christ. What is the old man? That is Steve under the authority, the bondage, the masterhood of my sin nature. We still have a sin nature. Jesus' death and resurrection did not eliminate our sin nature here on this earth. One day, it will be eliminated. We'll be saved from even the presence of sin. But for now, we still have that sin nature. But what Paul is getting across to us, and again, this is for the here and now, is that you've been crucified with Jesus, you're dead to sin, and the sin nature no longer is your master, no longer controls you. That old man is dead. And now you're alive, risen from the dead, with Jesus, to walk in a newness of life, living and serving God. And that led to the third point. So you gotta know that, you gotta understand that inwardly, just as you have to understand the gospel in order to be declared righteous to begin with. Don't try to earn it by your religious rituals, and don't try to earn it by your good moral upstanding life. No, no, no. Receive it as a gift of grace. Make that calculation, that reckoning. And then the third point is now, go actively live it out in this world. Use your eyes, your words, your tongue, your ears, your hands, your feet, your brain. Use the members of your body. We would call them organs necessarily, or organ systems or whatever. But use the parts of your body for God instead of for self and sin. That is where we kind of stopped last Sunday. So, the last verse, to repeat, from verse 14 of chapter 6, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. Not necessarily thinking in terms of the law of Moses, because the church at Rome was a lot of Gentiles too, but just that idea of if you want to look at the law of Moses and focus on the Ten Commandments, the moral standards. You're not under some set of rules and regulations and commandments to God. That's not what Christianity is about. But at the same time, the question, well, shall we sin because we're not under law but under grace? Verse 15, and the answer, certainly not. Paul's not repeating himself. Verse 1, chapter 6 said, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Again, talking about how God's grace abounded over all of our sins, and he dealt with that issue earlier. This is something different. This is saying, oh, so we receive God's grace. That means he doesn't really expect anything from me down here. I don't really have any obligations to live for him. So it really doesn't matter if I go and sin or not because I'm not under any law. And that's what he's saying. No, God forbid. That's the wrong thinking process. Hopefully you think God forbid as well. Can you imagine a Christianity where there's no, you know, call for moral conduct and godly living? And yet, as I said a couple of weeks ago, surprisingly, there are those who in the name of God's grace, oh, we have to always cherish his grace. We can't possibly think that anyone does anything for God to deserve anything when it comes to salvation. In the name of his grace, the moment you start talking about living obediently to God, they say, well, you're being legalistic, man. And as we said, that is a ridiculous idea of legalism. We're not talking about earning that righteous standard. See, that's why the steps are looked at in order. Paul's presenting them in an order. He doesn't tell you to go out and do these things without first establishing all this very clearly. So it's rooted deep within us, and it needs to be rooted deep within us. But having that now understanding, we are to present our lives unto God. And so, verse 16, do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one slaves whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness. The two masters that are involved in this slavery imagery, and slavery is deliberate. I reject completely the teaching today because slavery is such an emotional, you know, charged kind of idea and word, that when the Bible uses it in the teaching, that we should soften it and think of things like, well, just imagine like your employer-employee relationship. That's kind of what the Bible's trying to get across. No, it's not. The Bible has words for employer-employee relationship in other passages. An employer-employee relationship is nothing like what we're talking about here. Because, yes, it's true your boss may tell you to do stuff, and maybe you don't even like some of the stuff you're told to do. But you know what? You can tell the boss something, too, and go out the door and go find another job. But a slave has no freedom. A slave is under a master. And in the Roman Empire, slavery was dominant. Far more dominant than it was in this country, as significant as it was in this country. In the Roman Empire, estimates were as many as 1/3 of the population were legally slaves. Think about that for a second. About 1 in 3 people, a slave? Way more numbers than we would imagine. And it had nothing to do with your ethnicity. It had nothing to do with the color of your skin. It had nothing to do with your background. It had nothing to do with your education. You could be really rich. You could be really poor. You could be everything in between of any sort of ethnic or race. That's not what determined slavery. It was very different in that regard. But one thing was true is you were owned by another. And that person called your shots in life. You're going to do this when I say it, how I say it, where I say it, day after day after day. No, the Bible is being very deliberate in using that as our teaching. So looking at it again, do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one slaves whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness? Now, as we said so often, the Bible uses these earthly illustrations, earthly examples, earthly teachings that everyone could relate to, but then give them the spiritual teaching. Jesus is the one who told us no one can serve two masters. And look at the way Paul is presenting it there in verse 16. You see, this is where the earthly situation breaks down, and now you see that you do have a little bit of freedom. You get to decide who you want to serve. See, a Roman slave certainly never had that kind of freedom, didn't have that choice. But you decide, am I going to serve sin, which leads to death, or am I going to serve obedience to God, which leads to righteousness? Jesus says you can't serve both. And how many people try to serve both? Oh, I'm a servant of God, except for a couple hours on Friday night. And I'm going to do some things because I want to do them and all that kind of stuff. But I never stopped serving God, Pastor. Well, of course you did. For those couple hours, you can't serve both masters. And Jesus made that very clear, and we understand that to be true. Now, in the earthly institution of slavery, it was possible for the slave owner to lend out a servant to someone else, right? Hey, I want you to work in his field today. But that slave owner is still calling the shots, even though for that day, you're under someone else's supervision, right? Now think about it, what we're saying, without throwing out what we've established already. We're not talking about, oh, this is what you got to do or else look out, you're going to hell, you know, you're going to lose your salvation. No, we're not going down that road at all. But just imagine if someone is insistent on serving sin for those 2 hours on Friday or whenever the example might be. They're a servant of God, yes, ultimately. They've given their life to Christ, they've been born again, all that. But God's going to allow that, isn't he? So, all right, you want to serve sin tonight? Go ahead. He'll allow it. He's not going to, like, strike you dead, is he? Not typically. I guess it's possible. And there are a couple examples in the Bible, but that's not the norm. So Paul's saying in verse 17 now, as we continue, God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, this is your description before you were born again, before you trusted Jesus Christ, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered. You obeyed the gospel, and that is not a typo, because you think, well, you mean I believe the gospel, right? You will find in the Bible belief and obedience going back and forth, almost like synonyms. Interesting, isn't it? We know what we're saying. You believe the gospel. I believe Jesus died for me. But it's the also idea of obedience, because I'm not trying to earn forgiveness with God. And Paul says, so here's how you were. You believe the gospel, obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine in which you were delivered, and having been set free, that's what we talked about so much last week, from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. I speak in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented your members, again, your eyes, your ears, your mouth, and so forth, as slaves of uncleanness and of lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves of righteousness for holiness. We're told elsewhere in the Bible, sin is lawlessness. So how do you define sin? Well, that's how the Bible does it, at least in one way. Sin is lawlessness. God has a standard. God's standards are not flexible or optional. This is what God says. This is what he commands. This is his law in that sense. And I'm not going to do it. That's lawlessness. Maybe God is commanding a proactive act. I want you to do this. I want you to do this. And we don't do it. What they call a sin of omission, right? God says, I want you to do this. I'm not going to do that. Or God says, don't ever do this, and we do it, a sin of commission. But in both cases, it is lawlessness, and lawlessness just leads to more lawlessness. Sin just leads to more sin. But now, present your members as slaves of righteousness for holiness. Holiness means to be set apart for God. That's what the word means. You know, it's such a, you know, he's holy. You know, what does that mean, holy? You got, is it glow, got a halo or something? You know, holy means set apart for God, for God's purposes. Doesn't even have to be human beings. In the Bible, there are non-living things that are described as holy, like cups and plates and dishes and so forth. They were used for only specific purpose, typically in the temple sacrificial system and all the rest of it. But those were the holy dishes. So you didn't throw a sloppy Joe on there and watch Monday Night Football. You know, no, this is only set apart for God's special use. That's how our lives are to be seen today. That's what it means to be holy. I'm set apart for God. That's what he wants me to be used by him. That's what Paul's talking about here. And then this little reminder, for when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. Now notice that's almost kind of a play on words there. It's almost comical in a sense, right? When you were slaves of sin, you were free, because that's the opposite. What's the opposite of slavery? Freedom. You were free, but what were you free in regard to righteousness? In other words, you weren't doing anything righteous. Don't have to worry about any worry about righteousness. You're free from that because you're a slave to sin. That bothers, of course, many people because they say, how dare you? You know, I'm a good person. I try to live a good life and all those kind of things. But as Jesus said, there's no one good but God. Good's a relative word. And in human terms, it's thrown around very loosely. Someone says they're a good person because they're talking about some dirtbag over here, you know. They think, oh, yeah, you know, I got it over. I'm pretty good. It's a pretty low bar, a pretty low standard of comparison. How about putting God as the standard of comparison? Perfection, absolute, perfect, complete. That's why Jesus says there's no one good but him, because that's the standard. And that's why we all sin and come short of that standard. We all sin and come short of the glory of God. I am not saying, to be clear, that people who do not know Jesus Christ are incapable of doing things for other human beings that are very beneficial and positive in their life. I am not saying that at all. Someone who is hurting, someone who is in need, whatever it might be, and someone comes along and helps that person, or maybe invents something that helps society. All sorts of examples we could be used that are good in one context of discussion, absolutely. But in what we're talking about, that's not the same as righteousness. Godliness. And really, though it's not for us to judge, God is certainly more than capable of judging things like motive. Why did they do those things? A lot of people give a lot of money to charity each year. Their motivation, I have no doubt, is positive. They want to help that charity because there's a lot of charities. Why are they giving to this one, not the other? So they've got a positive thing there. But just ask yourself, knowing human beings as you do, if all of a sudden all charitable deductions were no longer deductible, would the same exact amount of money still be given in the United States? I think we know the answer to that is no. And I say that because that's often one of the first questions. Can I deduct this? Nothing wrong with taking a tax deduction. The laws of the land allow it or whatever. But you see, there's a different little motive there, isn't there? How about when Jesus says, when you give, don't let anyone know that you gave. Don't even let yourself know. You know, give with your right hand and hide your left hand behind your back, right? I mean, you know, his imagery is almost comical, right? You mean if I have them put my name on the big academic building that I just donated $10 million to the university for, that's not really what Jesus was talking about? No, that's not really what he's talking about. Now, you see, God knows those kind of standards of comparison. He knows the motivations and all the rest. It's not to say that it's just wrong or bad, but you see, we're talking so much deeper, so much, you know, higher. I know, higher and deeper, but you get my point, right? When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. And then the question to ponder, verse 21, what fruit did you have then? In the things of which you are now ashamed. The end of those things is death. Sometimes people try to pull a fast one by saying there's no pleasure in sin. That's ridiculous. Of course there is. The Bible admits that. Sin is very pleasurable for a season, for a short time. Of course, sin can be fun. It can be physically pleasurable, enjoyable. Absolutely, there's pleasure in sin, but only for a season. The question that needs to be stated, to put it another way, what fruit is there in sin? What long-lasting permanent effects are because of sin? Why is sin sin? Why does God call things sin? Because they are destructive to human beings that he's created in his image. They hurt yourself, or they hurt other people, or a combination of both. And that's why he says, not because he's trying to deprive us of the pleasure, deprive us of some fun, but because he knows that the fruit, the long-lasting consequences, are not good, and ultimately lead to destruction. Now, you can have two people on the farm that are both going to work equally as hard with their lives. They've got the same amount of hours in the day, and they are going to prepare some land, some soil, and one of the guys on the farm is going to plant some seeds, cover up those seeds with the dirt, get the water going, all that. And another's going to work just as hard, and instead of seeds, is going to put rocks. And cover up the rocks and start putting water on that. They're using their time in the exact same way, aren't they? And it's just as hard work, but which one is going to have fruit? Which one is going to have the results, you see? That's the thing. One can spend their whole life, and it's just a waste. And that's what he's asking. Now, again, there are those in our church, in every church, that have the benefit, and oh, it is a benefit, of coming to know Jesus Christ at a very young age. Thank God if you had Christian parents or grandparents or someone, you know, somehow, and you came to know the Lord at a very young age and really did your best to start living for him with your life and avoided a whole lot of misery that other people maybe have experienced. Hallelujah. It's not noble to say, well, I want a testimony, so I'm going to go live in the world for a few years so I can really shock them at church when I tell my testimony about how Jesus saved me. No. And sadly, a lot of people think that they might be missing out. Say, well, I don't know. I was raised a Christian. I was raised in a Christian home. I don't know any of that stuff. And boy, all my friends seem to be having a lot of fun. And, you know, I've heard the pastor talk about God's grace and all that, and I'm not, maybe I can go, But what fruit is there? There is no fruit. But for those of us, like your pastor, who did not have that sort of life, but rather lived for self, lived in the world, lived in the flesh, was led by the devil, a servant, a slave of sin unto death. And if that includes you, well, you know that you can look back on your life and say, yeah, what fruit did I really have? Oh, yeah, I remember that weekend. Yeah, I had a lot of fun in that weekend. But I look back on it and I think, how many people did I hurt along the way? How much money did I blow along the way? You know, all the different things you could go back on and look. And self-examination. That's what Paul's getting at, a little self-examination. The end of those things is death, he says. And you're now ashamed. Another thing about testimonies. We don't need all the nitty-gritty details. I live for sin. I live for self. Let's move on. Jesus saved me from that. So let me tell you, there's one particular Friday night. I'll never forget it. And then people start living vicariously through all the details. We ought to be ashamed of sin and ungodliness. And so, verse 22, but now having been set free from sin and having become slaves of God, you have your fruit to holiness. Again, the life set apart for God, and the end, everlasting life. And everlasting life, as I said over and over again, is not just a reference to heaven. Eternal life doesn't just start when you die. It starts when you have life, when you're born again. And then verse 23, such a famous verse, a verse filled with contrasts. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Death versus eternal life. Sin versus God. Wages versus a free gift. There will be no one who experiences the judgment of God who did not earn it. They're getting their paycheck. You live for sin in rejection of God, here you go. Payable to you. Everyone there earned it. I don't think it's fair for God to send people. They earned it. And there will be no one in heavenly glory who didn't receive as a gift, you see, because we don't earn anything. We don't earn our place there. Now, there is like spiritual rewards in heaven for how we live our lives and so forth. We're not talking that at all. And that verse is not talking about that. Now, as I said, 6, 7, and 8 go together. We're going to look at all of it, of course, but it's going to take us a few weeks. We have that sin nature. It's one thing to talk, and I don't like to use the word theoretically, but again, it's still kind of in the academic, and now we got to put it into practice. And as we all know all too well, that in trying to put into practice living a holy, consecrated life to God, I find my sin nature giving me a lot of trouble. And this is all fine. I agree with it. Yes, I agree, Paul. I've been crucified with Christ. All of that, I agree with it. And yet, here's the reality I'm still facing. Why is that? If that describes you, as it describes me, then you and I are in good company. Because it also describes the Apostle Paul himself. Think about that one for a minute. The Apostle Paul, as we get into chapter 7, is going to express that very same battle, that challenge. Oh, the things I want to do for God, I end up not doing, and the things I don't want to do, those are the ones I do. What a wretched man I am. That's the Apostle Paul. And he's going to give us the answer in chapter 8. He's not going to leave us hopeless in chapter 7. He's going to give us the answer. But I don't want us to wait for a few weeks by the time we get to chapter 8. So I just want to remind us of one other thing. This is also found in the book of Galatians, by the way. Galatians and Romans have a lot of similarity. Galatians was written first. It's a much shorter book. But some of the key points in Galatians are also key points of Romans that are then expanded upon. And in Galatians we read this. It goes back to my silly little planting rocks illustration. Because we reap what we sow. And Paul reminds us in Galatians, if you sow to the Spirit, you reap from the Spirit. But if you sow to the flesh, you reap from the flesh. What is this sowing and reaping all about? It's exactly what we're talking about, presenting your instruments, your eyes, your ears, your words, your feet, where you go in your 24 hours that we all get each day, and all of that. You see, that's our sowing S-O-W-I-N-G. And then we reap as a result. Someone says, I just have things happen. You know, words just come out. I just say that nasty insult or that cuss word or you know, that horrible flirtatious thing that I shouldn't say to another person. Oh, it just comes out, Pastor. I don't consciously think on it. Well, you're not unconscious when you do it, are you? And ultimately, anything we say, our brain told us to say it. Now, I get what someone's saying. I didn't like say, I'm going to make a choice to say this. It just came out. I get it. But your brain still told you to do it, and you did it. And this is where Jesus says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You see? All it takes is just that little, it's really popular today to talk about trigger. I got triggered. Just that little poke. And whoop, one reacts in the flesh. One reacts in a sinful way. But the reason that happens is not because you have a sin nature. The reason it happens to us is because we've been sowing to the flesh. Because if we're sowing to the Spirit, that same little trigger moment just bounce right off. And so this is where we're going in our study. This is the Christian life here and now today. It's not let's sing a few hymns and wait for the rapture. It's about being set apart for God in this world as His ambassadors, His witnesses to the world that He loves and He died for and that needs Him so greatly. Let's pray. Our Lord, we thank You for this time in Your Word, again, learning about who we are, what has been accomplished at the cross for us in the here and now, in this life. And Lord, we want to put it into practice. We want this not to just be head knowledge and theory. And so, Lord, help us. As we seek to present our instruments, we know we're going to look on something today, tomorrow. We're going to listen to something. We're going to go somewhere. We're going to do something. Help us to do those things that You would have us to do. We know they don't all have to be churchy things, Lord. But just to be led by You at work, at home, at school, with our friends, wherever it might be, Lord. Guide our path, we pray, so that You're glorified through our lives as we see ourselves as set apart for You, holy unto the Lord. In Jesus' name, our Savior, we pray. Amen.